Good morning students, welcome to class 10th. Today we are going to start with the first chapter, that is chapter number 6 of your biology, that is life processes. Now we see life all around us. There are many organisms which we see that are living, and there are many things which we see that are non-living. So how do we define, or how do we actually make a difference between the living and the non-living organisms? What is alive and what is not alive? How do we define? We say that we see a man running, a dog running, or a cat jumping on the trees. So that means this is the only way that we are seeing the living organism. Or what we can define from this is that an organism doing any movement means moving from one place to another, is a living organism. That is one criteria of define living organisms. But what if I say that I am sleeping, or a man is sleeping, or an animal is sleeping? So that means that animal is not living, it is still living, because there is still a movement going on within the body of the organism that is called as breathing. He is breathing, taking in oxygen from the atmosphere and releasing CO2 into the atmosphere. So that means when a person is sleeping, he or she is also, or when an animal is sleeping, is not causing any movement also, then also he or she is alive. You are dreaming something, so that means you are also alive. You are breathing, you are talking to anyone, so you are alive. So that means an organism which is showing any kind of movement, it is not necessary that we are moving from one place to another. Like say, breathing is not a movement doing from one place to another. It is within the body's organism. It is within the organism's body. So that means that organism is called as a living organism. That means one criteria of defining a living and a non-living organism is the movement. But now the question arises that the plants are also not causing any kind of locomotion. Now earlier I was talking about movement, and now I am talking about locomotion. So let us first understand what is the difference between locomotion and movement. Locomotion means displacing from one place. Like for example, I took a step and moved to the another place. So that means I am moving my legs to cause locomotion. That means I am displacing from one place to another. I moved out from my house for the school. So that is I am doing movement as well as locomotion. But if I am standing on a place and just moving my hand, so that means I am only causing movement. So this also applies to the plant. Plants are not locomoting, they are just causing the movement. So do we see the plants moving? The best example of this is the plant that is called as Mimosa pudica, jisko hum Hindi mein bolte hain chhui mui ka plant. Jisko hum chhute hi wo plant apni leaves close kar deta hai. So that means jab maine plant ko chhua, when I touched the plant caused the movement. So क्या हम ऐसा सोच सकते हैं कि जब हम प्लांट को सिर्फ टच करेंगे तभी वो मूवमेंट शो करेगा? ऑल्सो दिस इज नॉट द केस. यू सी एवरी डे द प्लांट्स फ्लावर ओपन ब्लॉसम इन द मॉर्निंग एंड बाय द इवनिंग दे क्लोज. इन द सेम मैनर यू सी सनफ्लावर प्लांट, इट कॉजेज द फ्लावर मूव टूवर्ड्स द सोर्स ऑफ लाइट, दैट इज टूवर्ड्स सनलाइट. सो दैट मीन्स देर आर सर्टेन मूवमेंट्स विच द प्लांट ऑल्सो शोज. हेंस plant is also a living organism. So up till now what we have done, we have studied about the locomotion as a part of defining organism, whether it is living or non-living. Now the movement caused by the plant can be related to growth, or it cannot be related to growth. Like for example, if a plant is increasing in height, so the movement is related to growth. But if a plant is just moving towards the light, so it is not related to growth part. Okay, now in the this was explained in your first paragraph. Now moving on to the second paragraph, it is said that movements over very small scale which we cannot see by the naked eye, are these also defined as the living organisms or the non-living one? Like for example, we start first with the microscopic organism, that is bacteria and fungi. Bacteria and fungi are the very microscopic organism. You cannot see them with the naked eye. When you keep your bread outside the refrigerator it becomes greenish, something start growing on it, that is green color part. Now when it becomes growing and it grows too much, then only you can see the fungi growing. But also within that part, the green portion, you cannot see the single organism. There are many fungi that are growing there. So that means there are many micro molecules or many microorganisms, not the molecules, organisms, which we cannot see by the naked eye. They are also living organisms. Then the certain scientists said that there are certain invisible molecular movement that are necessary for the life. So are these invisible molecular movement are also necessary for life, for defining the living organism as living? So yes, they are also necessary for defining living organism as living. Like for example, in your second paragraph, the example is given for viruses. I'm just marking that part. In fact, viruses do not show any molecular movement in them until they infect some cell. Like for example, nowadays you are sitting at home because of coronavirus. So a virus, when outside the body, is a non-living thing, and when inside the body, it is a living thing. Hence the scientists are still in a confusion, or there is still a controversy that whether the viruses are truly alive or not. So that means the invisible molecular movements are also necessary for living or defining living organism as living. Exception, we can say that viruses are the exception, because outside the organism they are dead and inside the organism they are living. So why are these molecular movements necessary for life? Now we have studied in 9 that the very basic unit of the fundamental and the structural and the functional unit of life is the cell. So when a cell comes together or it divides, then it forms tissues. Tissues then comes together, they form cells, and so on the body's organism, or the organism's body is formed. Now when a cell is placed in it can be a unicellular organism or it can be multicellular, any kind of organism. Whenever a cell is placed in an environment, so it interacts with the environment. Whenever it interacts with the environment, so there are certain substances which are broken down and certain substances which are made up. So in order to live, any organism which is living, the organism requires certain amount of things which are necessary for living. So, and the very basic requirement is the requirement of energy. So from where this energy comes to the body? The energy that comes from the body to the body is from the food that an organism takes in. We'll study in the later part about the nutrition part. So whenever an organism takes in the food, it breaks down that food and prepares the energy. But what is the role of that energy that is produced? That energy is required for the repair and the maintenance of the living organism. And that is what we call it as the life processes. That is, various living organism has certain processes going on in their body. Let's say nutrition, respiration, excretion, movement, sensitivity, then you have transportation. All these processes come together in the living organism to make them as, or to be called them as, living. But these processes also gets damaged, so they need to be repaired and they need to be maintained during the life of the organism. For maintaining these processes, our body requires energy, and for energy, our body taking the food from the various sources. Okay, so I have defined you what are life processes. That is the maintenance function, the repair and maintenance function of the living organism must go on throughout its life for its growth, for its proper growth and survival. Hence the processes require energy for that. So all these processes which require energy for the proper maintenance and repair of the organism, these processes are collectively called as life processes. That maintenance and repair goes on every time, whether a body is locomoting, doing movement, or it is not doing any kind of movement. Let's say we are just sitting, So we are doing movement, but it is an invisible movement. Let's say we are thinking something. So during thinking also, our certain cells gets damaged, or the lifespan of the cell gets finished. For example, RBC in our body has a lifespan of 120 days. RBC that carries oxygen. That cell needs to be repaired, or that cell needs to be reformed again and again for the body's proper functioning. When a person is sleeping, when a person is thinking, all the repair and maintenance processes goes on for the whole life. So these processes which repair and do maintenance by utilizing energy are called as life processes. Okay, now since these processes require energy, so the energy must come from a source. Okay, now the source can be anything. It can be the source in the form of a sunlight. Let's say plants take up the sunlight and they photosynthesis, and to do photosynthesis, photosynthesis means, photo means light and synthesis means forming something. So in the presence of light, they are forming what? They are forming the food, that is in the form of glucose. So that means when an organism is doing its own nutrition, that is autotrophic nutrition, we will again study that part in the next topic only. So these organisms are making their own food, but we are talking about plants up till now. When we talk about animals, so animals usually cannot make their own food. That means that animal has to be dependent on the external source for its requirement of the food, and that external source is usually the plant source. Let's say you eat vegetables, you eat fruits, so it is a food source, or it can be any organism itself. Let's say a tiger eating a deer, so deer is a source of food for the tiger. So source of food can vary among organisms, but that food is taken in from different sources, and when we take in that food, we utilize that food to derive energy. So that process is called as nutrition. Okay, so whenever you do nutrition, we take in the food, we utilize that food, we derive energy from that food, and that energy is used by the organism's body to grow further. Okay, now usually all the earth, life on the earth depends on carbon based molecules. So whatever food you take in is a carbon based food. Let's say carbohydrates, vitamins, or you can say proteins, fats. Not vitamins exactly, vitamins are certain, sometimes they are non-carbon based also. But when I talk of major nutrients, like for example carbohydrate, fats, proteins, so all of these are the carbon based source. Okay, now different depending upon the different kinds of complexities, like for example a unicellular, multicellular, or a more complex organism like humans, we have different carbon sources that we use for the nutritional purposes. Okay, now the source that we are taking in from, whatever the source can be, once we have taken in that food, we need to break that down to release the energy. Okay, and why do we need energy? For maintenance of various life processes. So that means for breaking down that food, there is a second process which is called as respiration. Respiration involves within itself two things. One is breathing means you are exchanging the gas from the atmosphere, and second one is the oxidation of food. Oxidation of food means breaking down of food to release energy, either in the presence of oxygen or in the absence of oxygen. Once that food is broken down, that is oxidation of food we have done, we release energy. Energy is taken by various cells, but when a cell releases energy, so what it has utilized? It has utilized food and oxygen. But in case of humans, that food and oxygen needs to be transported to various body parts. So hence we have now the transportation system, that is the blood, that is the transporting medium in our body. So up till now what we have done? We have studied the nutrition part, we have studied the respiration part, we have studied the transportation part. Now when a cell utilizes that food for producing the energy, so certain amount of waste is also formed. That waste, if gets accumulated in the body, it can cause, or it is toxic and it can cause harm to your body. Hence, that waste should also be removed out from the body. So that means what I am talking about is, I am talking about the process called as excretion. The toxic waste, that is, let's say ammonia is toxic to our body. So hence ammonia has to be excreted out from the body, and that process is called as excretion. Okay, so now what we have done, we have formed a link between all these life processes, starting from nutrition. We take in food, we break down that food. When we break down, so we call it as respiration, and for respiration we need food as well as oxygen at the same time. So a transporting medium came into existence, that is called as the blood, or we call it as the transportation part. Then when a cell is utilizing that food for the production of energy, it is producing various waste. That waste has to be removed from the organism's body. If it is a unicellular organism, then it is very simple. There is only a single membrane. From that only the food can be taken in, oxygen can be taken in, and waste can be eliminated out. But if it is a multicellular organism, let's say humans, so there are various systems. So hence there is excretory system, digestive system, transporting system, respiratory system. We have different systems, and all these systems must function in a coordinated manner so that all the life processes can work in a smooth way. So hence all these processes, starting from nutrition, respiration, transportation, excretion, all these processes works in a synchronized manner to bring about or to produce the energy that is utilized for various maintenance and repair processes of our body. Okay, so up till now this is the introduction part that you have completed today in the first class. In the next class I'll be starting with the nutrition part. I hope you all understood this part. If you have any doubts, so you can WhatsApp me, whatever doubts you have, I will solve your doubts there only. So that's all for today. Thank you. Please read out these first two pages. They are very important. They form the basic part of this chapter. And then we will start with the major various life processes part. You will study about this in detail after this. But please go through these first two pages. They are important. So we'll take up the doubts, whatever you have, in the next class. Or through WhatsApp I can take. Okay. Thank you.